Recipio scheduling is something that we have been talking about since the beginning of the semester. We have been talking about CPU scheduling, and we now understand what the scheduler does. So now we already know the what the scheduler does, but now we are about to study the how it does that. So what does the scheduler do?
Decides what process gets the CPU.
Yeah, exactly. It's that part, that important part of the operating system that decides which process gets the CPU, if there is one CPU, or which process gets which CPU, if we have multiple CPUs. Generally speaking, we have multiple CPUs, and the scheduler decides which process gets which CPU and for how long. Now, in the beginning, in the early part of this chapter, we will assume a single CPU to understand certain important concepts. Then, we will discuss multiprocessor scheduling. We will discuss the issues involved when we do scheduling for a multiprocessor system. So in the beginning, we will assume a single CPU. Okay. So first, some basic concepts, which in fact we already know. So we already know the concept of the CPU burst and the I/O burst. And we have, in fact, we have done some simulation of operating system operation, with CPU bursts and I/O bursts, and in fact, most students understand this very well. So, a CPU burst is any operation. A CPU burst, it consists of all the operations that do not involve I/O or do not involve system calls requesting something from the system. So anything, any arithmetic operation like add, multiply, or even memory operation like load and store, these are all considered CPU operations. But when you do something like read from a file, or read from keyboard, this is something that the process requires operating system intervention for. So it's done via a system call. So this operation marks the end of a CPU burst. This means that this CPU burst has ended, and now this starts an I/O burst. And the process will be waiting for I/O until that service is complete. Then the state of the process will change from waiting to what? Ready. So the process will never get the CPU immediately, right? We will have to put it in the ready state and then let the scheduler choose which process to get the CPU next. Okay? And so loads and stores, or memory operations, even though they are memory operations, they are not, when a process is performing a memory operation, the CPU may be idle, maybe actually idle, depending on the architecture, but during the execution of a load or a store, the CPU may be idle and the memory system is doing the work. But even in that state, from operating system point of view, that's considered CPU. That's considered CPU time. So it's a process has the CPU, whether it's doing arithmetic operations or memory operations. From operating system point of view, the process has the CPU. And it may not be utilizing the CPU well, and it, there may be a memory operation that will cause the CPU to stall, but from operating system point of view, that counts as you know, CPU, CPU time for that process. Okay. What is not CPU time is when the process is waiting for I/O. So, when a process is doing any of these operations, it's in the running state. Okay. So now we will look into, you know, this histogram that shows a distribution of CPU bursts. And this is just, you know, the horizontal axis here is the duration, the CPU length, and the vertical axis is how frequently does this, how frequently this occurs. And we'll see that the most common or the most frequent CPU burst length is about 2 milliseconds. While CPU bursts that are longer, or in fact longer than 8 milliseconds, are rare. It's rare to have something, you know, longer than 8 milliseconds. And why is that? Why is it, why are CPU bursts that are longer than 8 milliseconds rare?
Long time to go without any I/O.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a long, it's very unusual for a process to go for 8 milliseconds without I/O. I/O is what? You know, I/O is reading from input, reading from keyboard, writing to the screen, or accessing a file. Alright, so can you imagine a process going for 2 milliseconds? Now, how long is 2 milliseconds? How many operations will a process do in 2 milliseconds? What's a lot? So we need some numbers.
So, was that like millions?
2 million?
In the milliseconds?
Yeah. In fact, yeah. So there will be millions of seconds. So again, it's very important that you have a sense of, you know, these numbers and how long is a 2 millisecond time period in the context of a computer system. If we are talking about a 1 gigahertz processor, 1 gigahertz processor, that means 1 billion cycles per second. 1 billion or 10^9 cycles per second. And how many operations does that mean? Well, it depends on the operation. If we are talking about an add operation, that's 1 cycle. If we are talking about a multiply, that's a few cycles. If we are talking about a load or a store, that can take up to hundreds of cycles if it misses in all levels of cache and goes to main memory. So if this load misses in the cache and has to go to main memory, then that's hundreds of cycles. Okay, so the number of cycles for an operation depends on what kind of operation that is. And on average, you may assume that 10 cycles is a good average, or at most 100. 100 is too it's too long, and 10 is a little bit too short for an average number of cycles per operation. But if we use 10, then this is like 10^8 operations per second. So that's 100,000 operations per second, which means that in 1 millisecond, you will have, what, 10^5. Operations in a millisecond. So 10^5 is hundreds of thousands. So this, a few milliseconds is hundreds of thousands of operations. And can you imagine a process doing hundreds of thousands of operations without doing I/O, without reading from input or writing to the screen or reading from a file or writing to a file? That's why it's long CPU bursts are very rare. Okay. Okay. Now we will talk about the CPU scheduler. Our focus here is on the short-term scheduler, which looks at the ready queue and picks one process from the ready queue and gives it the CPU. Now, what's that ready queue? Well, the ready queue, in fact, in operating system terminology, they use the term queue, even though the ready queue is not necessarily implemented as a queue. It could be implemented using any data structure, including first in, first out queue, or priority queue, or even a tree. So, in fact, as we will see later, all modern operating systems have the notion of a priority. So, there's the notion of a priority. All realistic scheduling algorithms are priority based. And when it's priority based, you need some kind of priority queue or a tree to implement the ready queue. So it's the data structure in which the system maintains the already processes. Decisions will have to be made when a process switches from running to waiting by requesting I/O. When a process switches from running to ready, well, in fact, the process itself will not switch from running to ready. It's the system that will preempt the process or interrupt the process via the timed interrupt and take the CPU away from the process and give it to another process via the timed interrupt. So when we have this happening, a process getting interrupted with a timed interrupt, we call this preemptive scheduling. And this is what we focus on, preemptive scheduling. That, of course, requires hardware support. It requires a timer. You know, if you don't have a timer, you cannot implement preemptive scheduling, right, as an operating system. So this is an example of a hardware feature that an operating system needs in order to implement this this functionality, this operating system functionality, which is preemption. Now, if the system is non-preemptive, if it's non-preemptive, it's not going to interrupt any process. A process will get the CPU until the process itself releases the CPU, or releasing the CPU by requesting I/O. Okay. So the system will be making decisions when a process gets switched from running to ready, or when a process switches from waiting to ready, and gets switched from wait to ready when, for example, I/O completes, or when a process terminates. Okay. So now we'll talk about the dispatcher. So the dispatcher is that part of the operating system that basically implements the scheduling decision. So the scheduler makes a decision to give the CPU to process X. And the dispatcher implements this by doing the necessary work to implement this, like context switching, saving and restoring states, saving the state of the process that lost the CPU and restoring the state of the process that is about to get the CPU. Other things that the dispatcher does is switching to user mode. This is very important. When the system gives the CPU to a process, it's extremely critical to switch to user mode. Otherwise, what will happen? Like, say, if there is a bug in the OS and the OS fails to switch to user mode before it gives the CPU to a process, what will happen?
The user programs can execute privileged instructions.
Yeah, exactly. Then the user process may execute privileged processes, which is a disaster. So now the user process will have all the privileges of the kernel. Then jumping to the proper location in the process or in the program that we are about to resume or restart. And the time taken to do all of this is called the dispatch latency. Now when we evaluate different scheduling algorithms, there are multiple criteria that we can look at for evaluating scheduling algorithms. And this this chapter is going to be mostly about evaluating different scheduling algorithms. So the criteria that we can look at include CPU utilization, which is something that we would like to maximize, obviously. We would like to maximize the utilization of the CPU. There is throughput, which is, throughput means given a limited time period or a certain time period, what's the number of operations that will complete within this given time period. So this is the throughput. Turnaround time is the time from start to finish, or from the submission of a certain task to the system to the completion of that task. Waiting time is the time that a process spends in the ready queue. And of course, waiting time is something that we would like to minimize. Turnaround time is something that we would like to minimize. Throughput is something that we would like to minimize or maximize.
Maximize.
And there is also response time, which is the amount of time between submission of a task to first response. Okay. So these are related. So usually, in most cases, these are related. And a good system will do a good job at maximizing the criteria that must be maximized and minimizing the criteria that must be minimized. But sometimes there are conflicts or trade-offs. So sometimes optimizing one criterion may have a negative impact on another criterion. So for example, if I do shorter time quantum, will this affect the response time positively or negatively? Would this have a positive or a negative impact on response time?
Positive.
Yeah, positive impact. Because I'm making the time quanta short, so I'm allowing multiple processes to make progress concurrently, and the users of these processes are feeling shorter delays. So the system feels more responsive when I make the time quanta shorter. But will making the time quantum shorter have a positive impact or a negative impact on the turnaround time? The total time needed to complete a process, will that be longer or shorter with shorter time quantum?
Longer.
It will be longer. So it will have a negative impact on turnaround time. And why is that? Why will the total time needed to complete a process be shorter, longer? Will we make the time quanta shorter? Yes.
The kernel's using more of the CPU to switch.
Yeah, exactly. Because we will be spending more time in the kernel, and what the kernel will be doing is context switching. So we will be spending, or wasting, if you will, wasting more time in the kernel doing context switching. So shorter time quanta will have a positive impact on response time, but a negative impact on turnaround time. And how about throughput? Will it have a positive or a negative impact on throughput?
Negative.
Negative as well. So it's the time. So basically, you are getting less work done with shorter time quanta. You are actually getting less work done, but you are giving the user the feel that the system is is making progress or is responsive. So the user is feeling a responsive system, but you are actually getting less work done.
Yes. So it seems like what the user wants and what the programmer wants conflict. So how do you decide how your scheduler should operate when you make
it? Yeah, so it's, well, the system will have to balance. You know, sometimes, you know, there are trade-offs, right? The system will have to balance all of this. So there are user requirements and there are system requirements. So if I, you know, if I make the time quantum too short, then the user will be happy, but I will be, I will not be using the resources efficiently. So it will be an inefficient use of resources or poor resource utilization. So the system will have to balance all of these factors. Okay, now in this chapter we will be studying multiple scheduling algorithms, and the main criterion that we will be evaluating or using in evaluating the algorithms is going to be the waiting time, or more specifically, the average waiting time. Okay, so because usually when we optimize the average measure, but sometimes it may make sense to optimize the minimum or the maximum, like minimizing the maximum response time, if this to make the system more interactive. Thank you.